Now many have tried, many have tried, but they have failed miserably to try to attempt to copy something that looked like the Holy Quran. Arabic poetry and prose was as at its peak at the time of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, yet no one could do it. Instead, they were made a laughing stock. Some of their works are yet present in the historical books, and we can all take a look at them if you wish to have a giggle sometime. The challenge still exists today. There are 14 million Coptic Christians, Arab Coptic Christians, present in the world today, which means they were Arabs but Christians, generation after generation, who understand the Arabic language, who have fluency over the Arabic language. Yet, nothing so far. And inshallah, nothing till the Day of Judgment. Now the Quran also has a test for the non-Arabs. It mentions in Surah An-Nisa, chapter 4, verse 82, "Do they not consider the Quran carefully? Had it been from any other besides God, they would have found in it many discrepancies, many contradictions." So the Quran is challenging mankind, or challenging the disbelievers, that tell us of a mistake in the Holy Quran, a contradiction, not 100, not 50, not 10, one contradiction in the Holy Quran, bring it forward. If we were to say that a man wrote this book, this kind of a challenge, no man would give. It is like a student who gives an exam, ends the question paper, answer paper, by saying, "This answer sheet is perfect. If you can find one mistake in this paper, give me a zero." This is against human nature. So this could have been only a challenge put forth from the Creator Himself. Now many have attempted to take out mistakes, but all have either gone out of context, they have misquoted, or they have mistranslated. Many people have attempted. Not a single one has presented a theory or a mistake to satisfy the minds of the intellectuals. It is very easy to just say something out of anger or just a quick response to something, but the response has to make sense to somebody who understands, an intellectual. It mentions in Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse 59, "Ask the person who is well acquainted with those things." So if you find a mistake, ask the person who knows. Oftentimes, you might ask a Maulana who might be an expert on religion, having no knowledge of science. Although there are many Maulanas who have a knowledge of both. But if you ask a Maulana who didn't have knowledge of science, something related to science which was mentioned in the Holy Quran, and he said, "I have found a mistake," and he wasn't able to answer you, that does not mean that you have proved the Quran wrong. If you have found a scientific error, ask the expert in that area. Open challenge for all mankind. Now, consistently throughout the Quran, a research approach has been encouraged. The Quran encourages us to think, it encourages us to research, it tells us that revelations go in parallel with reason. Some people say that holy scriptures are beyond reasoning. Well, if this was the case, if holy scriptures were beyond reasoning, then any person could come up with a new holy scripture saying that, "I cannot explain this to you because it is beyond reasoning. You will not understand it. I cannot explain it." So revelation and reason go in parallel. People feel, even some Muslims, that you should avoid religious dialogue. Well, it mentions in Surah An-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 125, "You shall invite to the way of your Lord with wisdom and beautiful preachings and argue with them, debate with them in the best possible manner." Invite them to your religion, reason with them. Don't just say that this is this because it says so. No. Talk to them with wisdom, with beautiful preachings. Argue with them, debate with them nicely, in a proper manner. And tell them logically how what you are saying is the truth. Because we know it's the truth. Does any other religion offer that? Does any other religion say that let's sit and reason?
No,
I don't think so. Now, an interesting fact about the Holy Quran also is that the two words that have been used in the Holy Quran, one is Kalu, which means they say, and the other word is Kul, which means say or you say. Both have been used 332 times. They say 332 times, you say 332 times, which means there's a balance between what they say and what you say. Encouraging a dialogue, two people talk, they say and then you say, talk to each other. That's the idea. Research on things. Now let's come to the main core of our discussion today, which is, who is the author of this book? What is the source of this book? Who could have written this book? Muslims and non-Muslims agree that the Quran was first recited by the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, 14 centuries ago. There is no argument on that. It is also agreed upon that it was revealed in stages, which took 23 years. It was not revealed all at once. It took 23 years for the whole Quran to be completely revealed. The point of debate, however, is the source of this book. How did Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, get this book? They say either he got it consciously, subconsciously, or unconsciously, giving us five areas or five options of what could possibly be the source of this book. Number one, they say that he made it up, that Nauzubillah, he lied. He wasn't a prophet, Nauzubillah, and that he claimed to be a prophet and he deceived everybody. So he was a liar. The second option could be that it is a product of his mind. Nauzubillah, he had some kind of a psychological problem. He was delusional or had hallucinations where he believed that he was a prophet, where in fact he was not. So it was a mental state. The third one could be that he borrowed it from a person or from another previous holy scripture. Third could be that it is the work of the devil. And the fifth could be that these are all wrong and it is nothing but the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the five options. Let's explore each one of them. Starting with the first one, when people assume that perhaps he was a liar, the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. Let's look at the facts. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, was known among his people as Sadiq and Amin. This is a fact. The truthful and the trustworthy. He has never been reported to have lied even once. Never. Not once. People kept their belongings with him, asked him to keep them safely. Even his enemies. Even after he declared prophethood, still his enemies, although they called him a liar to his face, yet they still kept their belongings with him. Look at the hypocrisy. They knew he was not a liar, yet they called him one. Some people claim that the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, did it for worldly benefits. Some say that he did it for status, for leadership, for fame. The truth is that many of the false prophets that have come have done it for the same reason. For this very reason, for fame, for money, for power, for status, for all of these things. They always have a personal agenda involved in saying that they are holy prophets. Acquiring riches, leading luxurious lifestyles, having armed guards, personnel all around them. It mentions in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 79. Therefore, woe to those who distort the scripture with their own hands, then say, this is from God, seeking a cheap material gain. Woe to them for such distortion, and woe to them for their illicit gains. So imagine if the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, had in fact written this book. He's writing himself, he's contradicting himself, that woe to those who write it with their own hands and then say that it is from God.